Kitco News, special coverage of the Precious Metals Summit, is brought to you by Corvus Gold.
It's good to have both of you here. Both faces of Exploration Insights, Joe Mazumdar and Brent Cook. Welcome both to the show.
Good to see you.
We're in beautiful Beaver Creek in Colorado and Precious Metals Summit. Yeah, great to see you both in person. Last time we talked, we shared bear stories. That was a while ago. That was a panel.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
No. You were there. Yeah, we had a Zoom call there. This time we're going to be talking about stories of what you did in the past year. You were telling me offline that it's been difficult getting out. You were visiting more than 30 properties plus prior to COVID, and that's dropped significantly. But you're still able to do what you do. So tell us about that process.
Living in the States, I've visited probably 6 projects since COVID. Joe's been to a bunch.
I've got to 8 to 9, but the COVID issue has been not actually sometimes getting out of Canada, it was getting back into Canada.
Yeah.
So my first trip prior to this, just leaving the States, was going to Alaska about a month ago. And that was the first time I'd been out since, let's say February last in 2020.
How do you analyze companies without having to physically be there and do site visits?
Well, the trust issue with management and knowing the management team is more important. And so if you don't know the management team, it's harder to do that, recommend it or buy it in the portfolio if you haven't been to site. Like, I'll just give you an example. So this one company I visited in southern eastern Idaho, mm-hmm. like you can see all the maps you want, but you don't really have the scope and scale of the project and what the access looks like and, where are they going to get water from? Where's the processing plant? You don't get that sort of idea until you actually go there and see what's actually going on. And that's the real benefit of site visits and talking to the people that actually do the work.
Yeah.
I think also, we've got, 60 plus years of field experience, probably in 70 countries scattered around the world, and worked with people in each of those countries. So our Rolodex, if you will, there's people we know in these countries that know the projects, and so we can still get a lot of work done without having to get to site, although certainly getting the site is the best.
When you pick companies, and we'll segue into a specific company that we can talk about, but generally speaking, when you pick companies to invest in, what is your exit strategy? Are you looking for a takeout, or are you looking for companies that have the potential to start producing themselves?
I would say that, on the exploration side, because exploration companies, especially the ones listed in Canada, don't do a good job of transitioning to production, which is not the case in a lot of ASX companies,
That's interesting.
Because that's their whole modus operandi, is to take these projects into production. That's just the mindset of most ASX companies. But here, I would say most of the exploration companies, that's definitely the exit strategy. But still, the paucity of development projects right now because of permitting, and all the issues right now in the industry, sticking a few development projects in your portfolio is not a bad idea. And you look at that a lot differently. And that management team has got to have the operational, a totally different kind of mindset than the people that I'm looking to get taken out potentially on the exploration
side. From an investor's perspective, which kind of exit strategy yields a higher return?
It's the higher risk, higher return.
Yeah.
So if you're talking about the exploration story, that's probably the highest risk and very much the highest return. But what we've seen so far is with the retail influence, you can get that 10 bagger or whatever just with a news release. Mm-hmm. Now, still in this environment, you put out a really good drill intersection, no matter where you are, you'll still get a good response, I think.
Brent, you and I have talked about things we should look out for when picking miners. That seems to be a very popular theme, recurring theme that our viewers would like to cover. So let's revisit that briefly. So you mentioned to me before, when you're looking for a miner, a junior explorer even, a couple of things need to be on your radar. They need to be actually publishing their drill results, their data, and their ores data as well. So companies that don't release that kind of information to the public, at least, should be avoided. What other red flags would you put on people's monitors?
Well, we're seeing a lot of companies report grades in terms of gold equivalent or silver equivalent, which means they bulk up copper, lead, zinc, silver, and combine it with the gold, and some throw in cadmium and whatever. Those are different metals. And I think if you're look for me, you can call it a copper, you know, a gold equivalent per se, but the recovery you're going to get on those other metals is going to be a lot less. And that's often not factored, or usually not factored into what the gold equivalent is. So I'm okay with it, but I want to see exactly how much, you know, silver there is, how much zinc there is, what those numbers are as well.
Yeah.
So I know what the grade of the primary product is.
Okay.
So that's one thing that I've noticed people doing a lot lately that, you know, you want to be a little cautious on.
Of course, you have a Twitter account that you flag these companies that you don't think are legitimate, right?
I wouldn't say flag not legitimate, but I will raise a concern.
Concerns.
Something to delve into, yes.
He's always been known to be diplomatic.
Okay, let's talk about a real company, a real life company that you've both worked on, Liberty Gold.
So we both visited Liberty Gold. I mean, Brent lives close to 6 hours away or something like that. And I just recently made a site visit there. And so it's in the northeast corner of the Great Basin, which hosts a lot of deposits, obviously, in Nevada, but also stretches out to southeastern Idaho. The terrain there looks very much like Nevada. No trees, no nothing. Mm-hmm. It's an open pit heap leach project. It's called Black Pine, and it's operated by Liberty Gold. And you know why we like it is it's a big mineralized system, and it's amenable to heap leach processing such that you can have lower grades. And they're drilling more and more. The problem with Liberty happened, was it 2 months ago when they released, updated their resources or put out a maiden resource? The market was expecting 2 million because that's what the expectations were set by them. Because of assays and drilling times and that, the release kept getting delayed. But when they came out with the number, unfortunately, I mean, they had to use a higher gold price to get the 2 million. So it was 1,800, whereas people would have wanted 2+ million. If you tell somebody two, they're expecting more.
Okay.
Because they're sort of saying, okay, two's no risk because you're already telling me it's two.
Right.
So where's the upside in two? So are you going to give me 2.5? So I think more people were expecting 2.5, but they weren't expecting an $1,800 gold price. And then when you layer on, okay, now we're going to do a scoping study, retail walks, because now the exploration upside is gone. Because now they're thinking that you're going to nail the project to this 1.72 million ounce resource.
Yeah.
So now, recently, they've drilled this area that's over and above what they were drilling before, called the range front. And they've hit the same sequence that hosts the gold mineralization in their discovery focus area where they have the resource. So that, for me, is interesting because now the story converts back to what it was when we initially bought it, an exploration story, and not a development story.
Well, that's a good case study, yeah, Brent.
Yeah, I mean, that's when I went and looked at it, which is probably a year before you got there, that's what really excited me was I could see, okay, we got maybe 1.5-2 million ounces here, but down there in the flats, that's never really been tested, and the geology's right, and the recent drilling they did, I think, D4 zone?
Yeah, they call it a D4.
And they've hit, and it looks good, and we could see easy another million ounces added down there, and there's, you know, there's more over here. So this is back to being, in my view, an exploration story, and something that's going to grow to be big enough, assuming the strip ratio is not too bad, that I think a major is going to go after, which is our ultimate exit story.
Yeah. Because we don't want them to build it.
No.
That's not why we invested in them.
Are they going to build it?
Well, that would be the impression. That would be the impression retail has if you do a scoping study and you start telling people you're going to do a PFS.
Right.
But we would both rather that they just kept drilling. And so they were on the precipice of saying, okay, we're going to drill 40,000 meters and infill what we know and come up with the PEA and maybe a PFS. But now they've switched it to saying we're going to drill 60,000 to 80,000 meters and most of the new meterage is going to be in this new area.
Yeah.
So that's what really excites us and why I continue to hold that.
And the geologic team running it is you know, amongst the best in Nevada. So we've got confidence there. Management, they got plenty of cash. So it ticks every box that we need to see.
And the other thing would be, you know, you got Moira Smith there who basically found Long Canyon, which was sold to Newmont, but also their CEO is an investment banker who's managed to not have to raise money in the equity markets because he's divesting a lot of assets that they don't get any value for in Turkey. So yeah.
Well, you want them to get taken out, but yes. Is the environment right now ripe for M&A? Is there a lot of activity, any activity at all?
Well, there has been activity where people are close when they're looking for, they have an operating mine and it's running out of ore. We've seen a lot of incremental transactions in Ontario and places like that. But I think what we're going to be seeing is more M&A because, you know, if you look at the Barricks and the Newmonts, a lot of their production profiles are flat and they're just running to stand still. I'm not saying it's a Newmont target, but it could be a mid-tier target for some other producer who wants a foothold in the Great Basin.
And Brent, what are you looking at in terms of prices for M&A? Do you think $1,800 for gold is a reasonable price for any takeout action?
You mean the major company assuming an $1,800 gold price? I don't think that's what's going to happen. I think what's going to happen is if they can see, you know, this is fair value, be it $500 million for this, what we know, but we've got, like Liberty Gold, we've got, you know, square miles of exploration potential that has a real likelihood of scoring. They'll pay a decent price for the known with the upside for free.
In your experience, does the price of the gold or silver, any underlying metal, does that really matter so much versus, let's say, the senior or mid-tier's corporate strategy long-term? Maybe they have a plan already in motion for the next 5-10 years of what they need to buy things out, and the price doesn't really matter.
The price does matter because they can't go back into the dilutive M&A scenarios that they had before. But so price does matter, but it's always a competition between organic and inorganic. Mm-hmm. Can you build it yourself or do you have to acquire something? And usually, you know, with any kind of company, you want a layer of production that goes for 10 plus years. And that's what people are trying to generate in the exploration side. Yeah. You know, they want a 10 year, 100,000 ounce deposit that somebody would want. But you gotta understand that no company is using $1,800 gold to value a company. Most use $1,500 for resources and business plans for Barrick and Newmont are at $1,200, $1,250. Very conservative.
Let's talk about jurisdictions now. Have your views on your favorite areas around the world changed following COVID?
Certainly. I think, you know, we were talking about this earlier and he explained it perfectly, how we value I'll tell you what you said. No, go ahead. You know, how we actually make a decision as to what jurisdictions we'll go into.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is that you could look at, transparency.org about corruption. You could look at the Fraser Institute. There's a lot of information out there of specific countries about where you want to go into. Yeah. And the majors and the mid-tiers all do that because they want stability of taxes. They want to know that they have the ground, that the security of tenure. Yeah. And so when they actually enter a country, they have to be satisfied that exists. So for me, that's the best proxy. So if I have an exploration company exploring in a country that a major, mid-tier, or some other people operate, then I'm happier about them being there. If they're the only ones there, that first mover advantage can be a serious disadvantage sometimes.
Final question. What's the worst food you've ever eaten at a site visit?
I think probably there's quite a few, but what comes to mind is Inner Mongolia, looking at a real crap project. And dinner was, there was a pot about yay big boiling away, and there were two sheep feet sticking out of it, hoofs, hair, just boiling away, and there's hair and grease scum on the top and some potatoes.
You can just order a burger.
Yeah, no, that was all there was. That was not a good meal.
That reminded me, I'll give you another one, which Ghana, when I was coming back to go to the airport, and I stopped off at one of those highway stops. Don't ever do that, people. And I was getting ready to go business class back to Denver. I was working for Newmont, so I was looking forward to that. And yeah, I spent probably 50% of that 8-hour flight, you know, from London back to Denver in the first class toilet.
Wow.
Yeah, so don't eat things, you know, just because you're hungry.
Advice taken from off the road and on the field. Thank you so much for coming to the show today.
Yeah,
and,
good to see you.
Good to see you both.
Cheers. Thank you very much, sir.
Kitco News, special coverage of the Precious Metals Summit is brought to you by Corvus Gold.